prisoners, pain, murder, fearful guilt. Pray, their soul, fool devil, masquerade, bleeding hymns, heart.
Thank you. Thank you. Greetings, everyone, and welcome to the panel discussion for turn three, the
greetings,
final turn.
And welcome to the panel discussion.
Everyone, make sure to mute yourself. And then if you're going to speak later on, unmute yourself. So we are thrilled to welcome you all to this first exhibition produced in partnership between SFAI and SF Artists Alumni, also known as SFAA. SFAA is SFAI's independent alumni organization, which formed in March of last year as a means to keep SFAI alumni together and safeguard the legacy of the school through its people and collaborative projects. My name is Nikki Korth, and I'm the outgoing alumni relations staff at SFAI and also an alumna myself. Many people were involved in the manifestation of this exhibition partnership, so we want to take a moment to acknowledge and thank the people who made this possible on the back end before we get started. First and foremost, thank you to Kat Trotaris, former Director of Partnerships and Programs at SFAI, without whom this partnership would not have been possible. Huge thanks to Chris Paddock, SFAI's Technical Director and the person running the show behind the scenes. Margaret Tedesco and Leila Weefur, the curators of SFAI's 150th anniversary exhibition, Spirit of Disruption, and the people who selected the films from SFAI's archive to which SFAI alumni artists have responded in the program that we're watching. And lastly, but very importantly, enormous thanks to SFAA's exhibitions team for driving this exhibition that creatively uses our collective tools in this crucial moment to get the work, ideas, and visions of SFAI alumni and our shared history to the public, and to bring us together in viewership and discussion in doing so. So huge thank you to Maria Barbas, Lucy and Lou, and major thanks to Beth Waldman. Beth is SFAA's exhibitions and programming lead and the mastermind behind every turn of three turns. I'll turn it over to Beth now, who will be our moderator for the evening and will say more about the program and our panelists for tonight. Thank you, Beth, and welcome everyone.
Great, thank you so much, Nikki. Welcome everybody. Truly a creative effort. This is turn three, the last night of three turns. So we're thrilled. It's been an amazing weekend so far. And tonight's live screening was amazing, even though we were beating the rain and the weather elements back and forth and left and right. Congratulations to the featured artists this evening. And thank you all for joining us. I wanted to share a little bit about the idea behind three turns. It really came from a concept that many SFAI alum commonly remember. Our professors emphasize the experience an artwork can provide its viewer by offering them three different entry points. So three turns really looks to exemplify this approach to art making with its intergenerational, multifaceted, collaborative project between SFAI film archive artists and SFAI alumni. So it's been such a pleasure to work on this project. I want to start by introducing esteemed juror and faculty member Christopher Coppola. Welcome. And Christopher selected the film works that were featured this evening by the six artists. So we're so excited to have you here, and it's been a big honor to have your support.
It's been a big honor to participate. I love the way you're thinking out of the box. SFAA is my favorite nonprofit thinking out of the box and doing what they can to keep SFAI alive and well. So I just want to thank you for that.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. A lot of big hearts here. Christopher is currently the head of the film program. And
well, I used to be. Now I am the director of special cinema projects and studies.
Thank you. Upgraded titles left and right. Well, such a backbone to SFAI, you know, as an alum and a faculty member, and giving so much to the community. He's also been a member of the Directors Guild of America for 23 years. And let me know if I'm behind on any info either, but I understand your company, Plaster City Productions, has truly been a champion and leader in digital media for over a decade. And Christopher's-
well, you don't need to say all this, but they, I was labeled the name Digivangelist, which is nothing religious about it, but a very important woman named Jenny Jardin of Wired Magazine, who started blogs and a lot of the HD stuff, because she saw what I was doing before a lot of people were, she labeled me the Digivangelist, and it kind of stuck. But you know, as far as I'm concerned, celluloid, digital, if you can't tell a story, you don't have an idea, I really don't care. So just so you know.
Well, I like how you extend, you know, your production company offers a true foundation for a lot of the students. For everyone who doesn't know, his company produces low budget feature films on which SFAI film students can intern and learn working on set alongside professionals. So that's a very special gift to students. And
well, it's also a very special gift to the professionals to see the freshness of young filmmakers, particularly, I call them SFAI, Special Forces SFAI filmmakers, because they bring a lot to the table. So it opens the eyes to the professionals too. So it's kind of a two-way street.
For sure. And that's another layer that we hope Three Turns is offering, the intergenerational fresh aspects left and right. And with that, I do want to also introduce, it's such a treat, Vishnu Das from Los Angeles. Thank you for joining us.
And hey, thank you, Beth.
Yeah, Vishnu is the director of the Steven Arnold Museum and Archives. So he's here representing archive film artist Steven Arnold. And we're so glad to have you here. You're truly coming with a great breadth of knowledge to speak to his work and his film, along with Christopher, I know so much as well. And I just wanted to share a little bit about Steven Arnold. So Steven got his start as a film student at the San Francisco Art Institute, where just before graduation in 1968, he premiered his critically successful student film, Messages, Messages, at the Palace Theater at midnight alongside works of Man Ray and Georges Méliès. So that's pretty special. And this led to Arnold hosting a regular series of midnight art house and cult film screenings called Nocturnal Dream Show, which in turn became a film phenomenon in urban centers nationally known as midnight movies. His works are also in the collections of the Whitney Museum of Art, the Museum of Modern Art, and SF MoMA, amongst many others. So it's been a treat to showcase his work in Three Turns. And thank you so much for chiming in with us.
Sure.
Just a little groundwork before we get started. Anyone in the Zoom audience, please use the chat feature to include questions and comments along the way. We'll do our best to address them, but we're also going to have time towards the end for Q&A. So please put your questions and comments in the chat, as Maria said. And I just wanted to jump right in and Vishnu, maybe start with you. I was curious to ask you, how would you describe how the liberation of Mannique Mechanique was experienced by its audience in 1967?
Well, this film was shown at the Art Institute initially. I know a lot more about how the other films were received. This was Steven's first film that he made there. He was working at a store called India Imports in the Haight-Ashbury, which was one of the first shops in the Haight-Ashbury that sold esoteric books and things like that. And so that was really influencing. I could talk about, you know, his influence, what he was reading at the time. The film has a really interesting quality, and it's actually because the shutter was sticking on his camera. Yeah. So it gave it this really ghostly quality. And he was having a really hard time finishing this film. And he met Michael Wiese, who's another filmmaker. He made the film Hardware Wars, which was kind of a cult phenomenon. But they were reading Man and His Symbols by Carl Jung, the Tibetan Book of the Dead, Joseph Campbell. And so, you know, I think the original idea for the film, Steven was watching a model for one of his life drawing classes. And he thought, God, I wonder what's going on inside of that model's head while she's sitting there. So that was kind of the onset of, you know, what's happening, what's the internal dialogue of this being, and it turned into sort of an internal hero's journey with all of the masks, the different personalities that we're asked to wear, the kind of mechanization of being a human when we get stuck in our ideas of ourself. So It's this sort of internal bardo, sort of an internal hero's journey that she goes through. And I would imagine, you know, in 1967, that the audiences at SFAI loved the film, especially considering a lot of those ideas were really a big part of the culture at the time. So yeah, that's the best I can do in regards to that. I would have loved to have been there.
Yeah, me too. It just, yeah, it's, you know, such an interesting thing to consider, like how it was received then and how it's received now. And Christopher, how do you, if you do, or if you would, like, how would you introduce this film, or how do you introduce this film to your students? Oh, you're muted, sorry.
That's a really good question. And I think the best way to do this, I mean, I have to be honest, it wasn't one of the films I studied in great detail at the San Francisco Institute, so it was sort of fresh for me. I mean, I was doing the Maya Deren thing, the Cocteau, all that stuff. But so it was sort of refreshing. It was kind of new for me. So I think the best way to have you get an idea of what the film meant when I looked at it is to kind of explain my way I did the choices, if that's okay.
Yeah.
So I've done a lot of judging, and I've done a lot of judging for film festivals, technology, including a beauty contest in Albuquerque for Miss New Mexico. And that's one thing. And I usually, when I judge that kind of stuff, I say, okay, where's the originality? Where's the sincerity? Where's the energy? Where's the cat? Where am I captivated? And you know, all those things have to kind of have some percentage before I pick top winner. This is different. It's very unique because it's the idea of another film that there's an essence in there, not necessarily influence, because a lot of these films were already made, but an essence in there that they were submitted that somehow resonates with Mr. Arnold's movie. So I did it differently. First of all, I had to have three pretty stiff martinis, and I looked at the movie like three times, and I wrote a bunch of notes, like what was popping into my head at that time. And I could tell you, like, you know, the obvious would be, Kenneth Anger, Scorpio Rising, all things George Cukor, class films. Maya Deren, interestingly, Meshes of the Afternoon, because of the objectivity of things. But his film is not as, like, forcing the symbols on us subconsciously. His has a little playfulness, which I enjoy, though I love her film, but I'm not really into pretension. But her film doesn't do that, neither does Blood of the Poet by Cocteau. So I'm looking at all this and writing this down, and then I have questions like, things that pop into my head. Let's see, where is that? I just want you to have these things. I call them lenses. Like, how would I look at this film through different lenses? One is, you know, mortality versus immortality, the erotic versus taboo. Filmmaker with the camera versus child with the Barbie doll. Okay, that's a big one. The sacred and the profane, and the profane and the sacred. Greek gods and goddess versus Catholic saints. Stillness and motion, motion and stillness. You know, all this kind of stuff I'm just writing down. And then there's the not too obvious. I love this. The not too obvious things that just popped in my head. There's a Columbo episode 14 called The Trevi Collection. And it's a witch that makes a bunch of mannequins come to life and kill these people. First of all, I'm scared to death of mannequins. Mm-hmm. So even looking at, even though they're not mannequins, but they kind of are, you know, I was a little uneasy. So the martinis came in handy. and then, you know, I'm seeing Peter Greenaway, Prospero's books and also Bob Fosse's Cabaret. Why? Because of the gestures and the posing, you know, that popped in my head. And then I started seeing Marlena. What? Am I talking too much? I'm almost done.
No, go ahead. Sorry.
Some Marlena Dietrich mixed with Louise Brooks. I'm hearing Richard Wagner with Kurt Weill, Grand Opera with Three Penny Opera. All this is going on. So how do I process this with the films that people submitted? Well, it's interesting. I take all the things on index cards and I sit on them. And it's like osmosis, okay? It's osmosis. And I look at all the films again, and if it feels right in my gut, I pick it. So that's kind of the way I, on this film, this kind of, I'm curating something. I'm not, you know, picking a winner. So I thought this was like the best way to do it. Like my feelings for a film, I don't know that well, okay? So it was like new for me, but I had to like do that. And that's basically how I judge it. So I don't know how I would introduce this film. I mean, George Cukor, the music, like, you know, he's my mentor and I love films like this. I think George is maybe a little bit more innocent than Arnold in some ways, maybe because that's just what what you see is what you get. And I've looked at pictures of Mr. Arnold and you would know more of Vishnu, but I don't necessarily get the vibe as what you see is what you get. And that's not a bad thing. But with George, he is his art. And maybe you can illuminate, is Steven his art? That's a question for you.
What are your thoughts, Vishnu?
Yes. Well, first of all of those juxtapositions that you presented, those were very much ideas that Steven explored through his entire artistic career. God, and now I've forgotten the question that you've just asked me because
just the idea of like, I like looking at personalities and artists.
Sure.
And Steven, some artists are their personality and some aren't. Not that it's a bad thing. Some are right outside of it. What do you think about, was he like George that way?
Steven was, you know, he was extremely ethereal. He went to Ecole des Beaux-Arts in Paris and studied. He dropped out and went to Formentera and wrote Owsley and got a bottle of acid sent to Formentera. And they took acid every day for 3 months. So, and he was very much into meditation. He was almost always in a state of meditation, but this sense of humor that he had, you know, so he would dress himself, tons of jewelry, tons of stuff. But to him, it was sort of a neo-tribal adornment. So yes, he was very much his art, you know, and if you see where he lived at the end of his life, the way that he dressed, his paintings, the colors, he lived in vivid color, but all of his work was in black and white. Wow. And I think he liked that because of the shadow and light. He liked to bring that all in. So he was very much living the experience of this film as much as one can do that, you know? I mean, it's definitely reflective of the kind of, you know, awakenings that one might have through psychedelic experiences or deep religious experiences or spiritual experiences. Steven was not religious. He was very much about the individual, but I think he really believed that once you got all the way in, that it was all the same thing, you know, that there was this kind of universal consciousness that he was trying to get at and then using his own tension to explore and inspire his art.
Sounds like he was a character and he would have done very well with Toulouse-Lautrec and Eric Satie in France drinking absinthe.
Absolutely.
I can visualize him at the table.
Well, it definitely seems like his work and his personality extends a lot of open channels through books, through countries, through layers of, you know, experience, spiritual, psychedelics, conversations, dialogue. And, you know, I'm really curious to hear, especially in light of the work shown tonight. I mean, Our hope with Three Turns and the idea behind it is almost to extend the very spirit of Steven Arnold in the sense of how can one conversation, how can one artist, the one film grow into so many different things. So tonight on the tower, we saw this collaboration and truly in the spirit of filmmaking, it seems that, you know, the team and the weather and this conversation is helping that dialogue grow into something new. So I'm curious, with with all these layers. What extensions did you see, especially from these more contemporary voices? You know, it's not the late 60s anymore, so the artists are coming from a completely different decade. And Christopher, you brought this up as a great question last night, and very much on the forefront of this project in our mind is, you know, how would you speak to what you saw happening then crossing over in time tonight with the works?
Is that a question for Vishnu?
Well, for both of you, really.
Why don't we have, because Vishnu is like, he's sort of representing Mr. Arnold here in spirit and style. And so,
yes,
to hear you. Like, how does his film and his vision and his life work with what you saw from this decade, so to speak?
Well, sure. You know, we'll start with the last one. You know, domesticate. You know, this idea of bridging our innate, intuitive, primal knowing with the roles that we are asked to play in society, which can often be extremely rigid. I found that self-portrait as a diver, this idea of it being that within one incarnation, we can have many different expressions of ourselves within that. And that this filmmaker, you know, made the film of when he used to be a diver. So it was this idea, and then the way that it was edited,
right,
felt right.
I like that film too, because of the subconscious concept of a diver. You know, a diver is a mask, but once you're under, there's a lot of other stuff going on. So I like that.
Yeah. The Ode to Oscar Wilde is hilarious. Absolutely, absolutely hilarious. And I mean, for those of you who don't know, there's a quote of Oscar Wilde's. I can't get the quote right. Christopher, do you know the quote? Do you have it memorized?
I don't, but I know what you're gonna say.
It's something like, the wallpaper and I are fighting a duel to the death. One of us has got to go. Something along those from the Ballad of Reading Jail.
Kind of like in a different way, like the Mark Twain quote, you know, heaven and hell. He doesn't really want to go to heaven. He should, but all his friends are in hell. So, I mean, for some reason that works, you know?
Sure. Mergence, that film had a lot of, it felt very similar to me in many, many ways. Just this idea of dealing with our boxes. Yeah. You know, dealing with the boxes that we find ourselves in, and the internal processes that fulfilling these roles cause us to go through. So,
is this the first time you saw all the film? Because I've seen them a lot, but
was the first time.
Yeah, this is good. Filmmakers is a first way of seeing your films in conjunction with what he knows about Mr. Arnold. So this is where you got to listen. Okay.
Yeah.
Listen.
I mean, this is really, I mean, I'm looking at the other film, Act of Renaissance. Again, it's just these ideas of internal awakenings, creating external awakenings. Or, you know, it's like what's happening in our society right now. You know, I kind of view it as the same thing that we do when we run up against the same problem over and over again, or the same lesson over and over again, that we're facing that on a societal level, you know? So as I was watching Act of Renaissance, there were these ideas that were coming up in my mind about the power of creativity to change things as much. Chogyam Trungpa is a brilliant Buddhist teacher who started Naropa Institute. Oh. And he said, the only way to change a society or culture is to change the society. The only way to change a society is to change the art.
Yes.
And so that's like this very important role that artists have to reflect society back to itself. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and it can't be idiocracy every time, because that seems to be the reflection we're getting right now in a lot of ways. But, you know, I think that's what I've got. I missed Barry's film. I missed All of a Sudden the Truth Became.
Well, definitely carried amazing energy. Did you get to catch Barry's film, Christopher?
I saw them all
individually. Yeah, yes. There was a very interesting
together, yeah.
Yeah, dynamic on the tower, and Barry's stood out. And the fact of how sound and visuals are playing together. Go ahead, Vishnu.
Go ahead, Vishnu.
No, that was fine. I did catch it because that film had some really extreme electronic swells. Mm-hmm. That's what was going on. And it's interesting, you know, Steven, you know, Luminous Procurus, I think, was one of the first films to be entirely scored by a Buchla synthesizer. So as that crazy noise was going on, I was like, this is in Steven's universe. It's fine.
And I didn't consider this at all looking at films, but Barry was one of my students way back. Mm-hmm. And what I like to teach is being able to hear film and see music. And I was very impressed with this piece because he really kind of got it, you know? Mm-hmm. He got it, that dance between the two. That's not going on, obviously, in Mr. Arnold's movie, but what's going on there is like how George uses music, how Bruce Conner uses music, like dealing with the icons of the film. But the idea of playing, like start with an idea and then playing with how the sound and music interprets that idea and how the visuals interpret, and then they dance. And I had to write to him. I said, man, Barry, you went up and you just taking it to another level. And I was very proud of him.
I'm so glad you said that, because I was really interested in this dance and this dialogue, you know, which, if any particular pieces or elements from what you saw from the collaboration, from the dance, really extended, perhaps extended certain elements in filmmaking, or, you know, what extended Arnold's work into a new dimension by having that dance. So
absolutely, you know, that was what, when I first got to the live stream, I was noticing this mad electronic swells, and I would like to see all of these films, you know, streamed. Is there going to be a way for us to see them individually, or are you going to put them up so that we can actually hang out with them?
This is all being recorded, so the whole project will be something we can share through a link. I see there are a few artists here in the audience. Maria, maybe you can help me. I'd love to invite Wichar Sand, or would you like to join the conversation? I'm really curious to hear, you know, there were three films in three turns where artists could select work to respond to or submit work to have this sort of dialogue. And we love to hear your thoughts. Great. Wichar, if I'm saying your name correctly, would you like to unmute yourself and join the conversation? Can you unmute yourself? Oh, there we go.
Hi. Thank you for having me. Thank you, Christopher Coppola.
Can I just say this to Water one-on-one? Because he worked on Sacred Blood, and he was one of my students way back, but he worked in the costume department. And I had a thing with Water. Like, he was always peaceful, so peaceful. And filmmaking, it's like 95% pure hell, at least, you know, long form, any kind of filmmaking. You gotta love it. And the 5% is gold, but Water was so every time I saw him, I said, hey, Water, if I told you today how happy I am to see you, and this has been a long time, I'm looking at you now, and it's gonna say, I'm so happy to see you. All right, just want you to know. All right.
Me too, Christopher.
Okay, but talk about, you know, I mean, I read a lot of the stuff that people wrote, like why they submitted that film as a view of a film, and some of it was a stretch, which is cool, because in those stretch, you know, ideas and seeing it, it's kind of fun, you know, like, how would I interpret that? How would I interpret Chuck Norris movie with, you know, Mr. Arnold's movie side by side? That's kind of fun, you know? But there's a little bit of that with some of the films, but why did you submit your film, which is different than anything I've ever seen you do, any work, but why did you submit it as a view of Mr. Arnold's film?
Well, the film I like to do, first of all, is a superimposition in the 16 millimeter. I first start with the 16 millimeter black and white. Mm. And it was successful. And I try to do with color. So when I film, I try to cut the exposition to half time. And I rewind the bullets and I shoot again with half exposition. And it's come out nice.
Beautiful, but you're not answering my question, Water. Why that movie submitted as a view of Mr. Arnold's movie?
I get your question now.
Why you? Like, why that film?
Because when I look at the Steven Arnold film, it looked to me like he tried to explain a myth or story of the puppet. And my story is kind of the myth.
Right.
It's kind of the explanation of where love comes and where the birth comes.
And I definitely felt that pretty deeply, but I also like to look at the little idiosyncrasies and symbols. Like, you know, Mr. Arnold used masks. You use this kind of, you know, objects, kind of with the, you know, like ghostly objects. And then he made use of poses, still poses, movie. And you know, the people in your film also had certain facial expressions that were, just felt like they could be posed. They weren't, they were organic, but there were clear facial expressions and things that I saw in body. But what do you feel, Mr. Doss, in terms of the film he made and you know, how it connects with what Mr. Arnold made?
You know, as I said, during this time, Stephen was reading was The Hero with a Thousand Faces, the Joseph Campbell book. Mm-hmm. And that's, you know, that inspired Star Wars, Harry Potter, probably The Lord of the Rings, you know, all of these great epic, you know, mythological journeys. So, you know, that's, and a lot of those are the external journeys, you know, and like I said, this one's about an internal hero's journey. So yeah, this idea of myth and carrying on myth is very much a part of this film.
And we also have artist Dipali. I don't know if you're interested in joining too. Since we have six artists, we invite you to comment on that. You know, I was noting a number of the terms that artists brought up in their statements. These terms, musical thinking, exaggerated backdrops, animal instincts, bodily experiences, and the idea of myths. So Dipali, welcome. Great, yeah. She has been in all three nights of our three turns, so that's terrific. And I'd love for you to speak to your work and your inspiration to submit a work to Steven Arnold's film. You probably heard some of the feedback and comments from tonight.
Yes, definitely. Thank you very much, Christopher Coppola, for like selecting me. And I wanted to like thank you, Vishnu, for being here. And it was a great honor to be beside Steven Arnold's work. And I learned a lot about him today. And basically, this work I created for my thesis work. And I'm pursuing my master's. I'm in my final year. And when I went, I looked at this work and the aesthetics of the work did match to that. And then when I'm hearing it now, like what Steven Arnold, his character and his works, and I started like thinking like I'm like really like into that, and my works are about these things, and I'm like really spiritual, not religious, but thinking about meditation, and a lot of my works are about those things. And this work, particular work, Mergence, was created as a follow-up work of a work which was being critiqued very like really critiqued by my school, which was about meditation. And I created another work to just merge in with what they wanted to say and what they wanted to portray me as. So I was just trying to merge in their tone. And so I was just trying to merge myself with, and the first work which I created was with this ice cube on my head. And they were very scared about about me being harmed because of that. And I had to stop that performance. And this was a response for that. And I was just trying to be invisible in that world, being there but not there. And yeah, so that is how this work came into.
I can give you a little bit more of why. I mean, I really liked your piece a lot. And it was the mask thing, and it's the internal subconscious that you were saying, Vishnu. But we forget that even though there's a mask and there's an internal, there's a face with a mask. And there's that little space between the mask and the face where you're trying to breathe, you're trying to feel like, you know, there's a certain energy there that's both terrifying and kind of beautiful. And that's that middle ground. And I found that fascinating, the way you reacted to that, because it was both the subconscious and the mask, but you really, you drew me into that little sweet spot, you know, that microtone between the two tones of your skin, the face of your skin and the mask. And so I just wanted to say bravo on that, because it really resonated to me.
Yeah, and basically, like, my whole thesis is about liminality and, like, the in-between space. And I'm coming from India, and I'm in this new country. And, I've been to San Francisco, but then to, like, the Western country and East, like, the Indian, there is, like, a gap. There is this gap, and I'm just trying to fill in that gap, and which will melt one day. But so, yeah.
How did you feel about seeing your work right there with Steven Arnold's on the tower tonight? How did that feed into your own understanding of your own work? Did you?
Yeah, that was so exciting to see that work beside the work, and how it was being located, the positioning of the timing of the work was like very interesting, because when that face came and my face is there where I'm like trying to like, you know, paint myself white. And I was thinking about like, I never thought about like many queens, but definitely I look like one. And a new conversation started in my head about like being a puppet, right? Like, yeah, that's what was happening. Like that response which I had, and the work which I created was because like I was being like, I had to fit in that environment where I was not being accepted. Mm-hmm. And so that was like a mini queen, right? Like, you know, puppets. And yeah, so I think, yeah, a new area of conversation has started within me where like I might expand.
Yeah, it was very powerful to see those up here. I see a question that's come in. I just want to jump in and share it from Titus.
Can you wait 1 second, because Titus is one of my guests. And I just want to say, he's somebody I just met. He's from Seattle. He's a young filmmaker. Well, you know, I guess 38 is young since I'm 59. But he's a very smart young man. He's about to direct something that I'm going to look at while they're doing it. And I invited him here because I told him how important it is to like experiment and see what artists do. And not that he's not an artist, but he is. But to see what the art world, the so-called underground, the experimental does. So I just want you to know that he's a guest of mine.
Oh, thank you. Well, Titus, we're so glad you're here, and feel free to join us here in the conversation. I'll read your question. You wrote, "I have a question about the working relationship of Steven Arnold and Michael Weiss. Did they collaborate frequently while attending SFAI? I've met Michael a few times, super nice guy, but Hardware Wars and Messages are two very different worlds." Vishnu, do you want to jump in first?
Well, sure. Michael is a good friend of mine as well. He lives in Cornwall, England, and he actually runs a spiritual book publishing company now. He's a very, he met Steven, he was from Illinois. He came to SFAI. He describes Steven as a seahorse when he first saw him. He had on all of this stuff and this hair, and he was, you know, amazed by Steven. And they did this film, The Liberation of Mannique Mechanique. Michael helped Steven finish editing. The various incarnations of a Tibetan seamstress, which is the next film that Steven made, Michael helped edit. And then they made Messages, and another film called The Elements together. They were trying to make a film called Monkey, which was the story of the Monkey King, which is the story of a monkey who brought the Dharma to Buddha, to China from India. And Michael and Steven were trying to make that together, but that sort of fell through. And Steven made Luminous Procurus, and Michael went to Japan to study with a very famous filmmaker whose name is escaping me right now. And so he went to Japan to do that. So Hardware Wars was a collaboration with someone else. So it was, that movie is Michael's sense of humor, but it's less his heart, I guess, you know, than Messages was. Messages, Steven and Michael were living together, meditating together. There's this beautiful image of them in their studio, which was in the Mission District. And Steven is in child's pose with his forehead to the floor, and Michael's forehead is to the back of Steven's forehead. Michael said that he was trying to drip his ideas into Steven because he couldn't find the words. So they were very close. They were very close.
Well, I love that narrative that you just brought up. It almost comes back full circle to how Christopher started exploring the works for this show, you know, osmosis or however.
Yes. You gotta say it right, man. Osmosis. All right.
I'll give it a shot, you know.
I get screenplays submitted to me and you know, more in the past than now, because now I just write my own little things. But, you know, I got to sit on it. I mean, I read it and think, but it's not enough. I mean, you got to sit on that sucker and feel it. And if it doesn't get up there, I mean, come on, you shouldn't be making it.
Well, I think that's the fun part of having this discussion between the two screenings tonight, is because it gives us a little time to sit on it, you know, in some symbolic way, you know, to hear the background, Vishnu, just all the stories you're bringing to everyone tonight, and Christopher, you know, your background and knowledge and stories too. I mean, this enriches the dialogue that we have in words and without words, is really the layered experience of art that I find I value so much. And we are gonna be able to fit in an encore this evening. I think the rains are easing up a little bit. I did I know these our brief programming maybe should have been longer programming, because it seems every night we want to keep going on. But I just wanted to see if there are any other questions out there before we maybe have to wrap up, sadly.
I think Vishnu had another comment. Go ahead, Vishnu.
I pulled out some things.
Oh.
That back there, this clown's head that's right there,
mm-hmm.
that was in the film. The scene when she's got all the masks, you know, that shows up. It was a Barnum and Bailey paper mache clown head from the 1920s. And wait. And then this is a painting that Steven did as inspiration for the film. And that's Ruth Weiss.
Oh, wow.
She's the guiding force. She's kind of the character that comes to Sonia when she first falls into herself. So I wanted to share that, you know, kind of visual inspiration as well. Yeah.
Can I thank you, Mr. Doss? I had a long drive and I'm very scared of mannequins and certain kind of masks, because that mask you just pointed out there in the middle, I can't sleep tonight. I just want to thank you for that.
Wow, that's Zanzibar. Steven's studio was named after that clown. So, and then Kuka is the mannequin next to him. She's from the 20s. You're welcome.
Well, I want to thank you both for being here. So many stories to share. We'll have to do another round of three turns or something, but we're going to probably kick off the encore filming now. And
before you do that, Mr. Doss, when I'm in LA, you and I have to go together, meet and talk, because I think we have.
Yeah, I made a documentary film about Steven called Steven Arnold Heavenly Bodies. So anyway.
Just to hang out and talk about a lot of stuff. I mean, Joseph Campbell, Houston Smith, you know, all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
Enjoy that.
Just got it. Yes, please reach out. Yeah.
Well, that's been my favorite part about this programming in between, is the connections that we've been able to make over these three nights. So this is another one, and these conversations, and even though we're virtual, I think we're able to extend and share, and you know, have a new starting ground. So it's an honor of mine to connect with you both tonight, and for everyone, the artists who are participating tonight in our turn three, thank you so much. And everyone can click on that same link to see the encore presentation. And we're all just so thrilled. The whole team's been thrilled about this three turns experience and appreciate this partnership with SFAI, and love keeping the fire alive through SFAA. So thank you, everybody. And have a terrific night, Vishnu and Christopher. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
listener, thought, man, kill, kiss, tears, love, young, old, lust, cold, death, shivering, kiss, prisoner's pain, murder, fearful guilt, pray, death, soul, fool, devil, masquerade, bleeding hymns, heart.
Oh,